Hello world, I'm Astral here, and today I will talk about the Thinking Fast and Slow book, and it was a very interesting book, but first I just wanted to say thank you for being with me. This is my 7th episode in my video series, so yes, let's begin. So this book was about our two types of thinking, and first, like the obvious one is like this is a slow and it requires mental effort, and this is like the usual thinking when you just think about a math problem, for example. And the second one, not usually talked about, is like this fast thinking, and this book was mostly about this because it is not really appreciated or not really talked about. So this is an automatic and quick, and we don't control it. So like this is, for example, the focus of your eyes, or like creating the sentences in your head. And we also make stereotypes with it because our brains can process this amount of information, so it must make stereotypes. And this fast thinking neglects ambiguity, so there are no possibilities. It just wants to have like a certain outcome, like that will happen for sure. Then because dealing with like 1,000 possibilities requires a lot of mental power, and like this fast thinking is without mental power. So humans in general like a single outcome that is certainly happening, and like it's also very true in the stock market. People often want to know just if a single thing is happening or not, or will happen or not. They don't think in possibilities, like there is a 20% chance of happening something. And this also suppresses doubt, because we don't like having doubts, because who does? And like we do a survey, and there is some statistics, and we want to explain statistics by something, by some trend, even if there is no trend and it's like there was an error in the survey, or like that was just for by chance something happened. So there is no single solution behind a lot of problems. So, and then it talked about going with the crowd, and going with the crowd is like a very basic human behavior, because we are a social animal, and we don't like being alone, because who does? And people easily go with the herd, but they go even more easily if they are engaged in another task. So their mental capacity is required by something other, and they are in a good mood, so they are having a good day, and they don't want to like think about anything, so they just go with hurt. Or they are very depressed and they are just thinking about how bad they are, then they often go with hurt. And last and most interesting was that if they are made to feel powerful, like I haven't heard about it, and like it's a little bit bad that if somebody is powerful, they more easily go with the herd. And I have seen this phenomenon in films as well, when they like pledge like, "You are so powerful, please help us." And I think they make use of this tactic there as well. And next we talked about interviews, and during interviews, like people rely on their personal judgment with the person, about the person, like very much. And you shouldn't, and it says that you should use formulas instead, like giving points. And it also helps if you make an interview with another person. So like the two of us perhaps can make like greater decision. Of course, your gut feeling can also help you in a lot of situations. And then there is this social pressure. And it made a case that experts must be confident, because like if an expert is not confident, then they destroy their own social image and nobody wants that. That's a problem in our society, because like even if an expert doesn't know an answer, like they just state something in order to like be an expert. But like because they state that thing very confidently, we tend to trust in them for two reasons. First, they say it confidently. And the second is that they are an expert, and we tend to like give value to experts' words and to their titles. And then it talked about loss aversion. People don't like risks, because losing your wealth is much more painful for you than gaining wealth. And for example, giving up a bottle of nice wine is more painful than getting an equally good bottle is pleasurable. People don't like giving up things. Yes. And we tend to overweight low probabilities. So for example, there is 0.0001% chance of a meteorite hitting Earth. Even, we overweight this probability, so we like build bunkers and hide there, or we like completely erase them and we don't even think about them. And neither of them are good. And then it said something about trying things, and it said that people often won't try something because of course a good outcome will contribute to their reputation, but the potential benefit is smaller than the potential cost, because success is generally a more normal outcome than a failure. People generally succeed, so they dread failure because they don't want to lose their reputation. And the next point was about that the framing of a question is very important. It said an example about two questions. The first, the same question framed two types. The first question was that there is 90% chance of there is a game, and there is 90% chance of you giving me $5, 90%. And there is 10% chance of you winning $90. So yes. And the second question was that there is a lottery with a $5 fee of entering. And there is a 90% chance for you for winning $90. Or 95, and that's like the same question, but framed differently. And of course, the second question was a much more popular one. And in order to protect yourself from that, you should really, really use your logic and think behind the question. Is this question trying to make you do something that you don't want? And the last point was about remembering how we value a long period of time. And when we remember a situation, we tend to think about the most intense moment, and we tend to ignore the duration. So for example, you had a 5-year marriage, and it was a lot of fun, but in the end, you had an argument and you divorced, you got divorced. And after that, you will have a negative memory of the marriage because you just think about the most intense moment, like the last day when you had this terrible argument. And like there was a bad outcome to the whole marriage. So you only think about that marriage was bad, even though you had 5 years of fun. So we like ignore the duration of things. So that was all. This was a very interesting book, but like very, very, very long. Like in PDF, it was 670 pages. So you shouldn't read it. I think it was a very interesting book, but like these points are enough for you. Of course, you can read it. Yes, so that's it for today. I have a Twitter account and I also have podcast and YouTube videos, so you should check that out. They are in the description. So that's it for today. Bye bye.